And we thought the high road was hard. The majestic marsupial is back, ladies and gentlemen. And no, I'm not talking about myself this time. Crash Bandicoot 4, it's about time. You're damn right, it's about time. Released last Friday, and I am going to review it. Now, admittedly, considering the dark existential and psychological content I usually put out on this channel, it might seem weird that I'm reviewing a game like Crash, you know, something with such a colorful and joyful presentation. But hey, we could all use a break from depressing stuff from time to time, right? Especially in this year. I certainly could, and I can't think of a better way to take a break than to talk about my love for Crash Bandicoot. I love Crash Bandicoot. Love it, love it, love it. Specifically, the original Crash Bandicoot trilogy by Naughty Dog, as well as Crash Team Racing. I grew up on these games. I think I started playing them when I was like 5 or 6. These were the games that more or less introduced me to the medium of gaming and the oodles of fun that were in store for me in my childhood. Like with many other OG platformers like Mario, Banjo-Kazooie, or Spyro, the basic gameplay formula for Crash is timeless. I can pick up either the original PS1 versions of these games or the recent remasters and have a blast trying to solve all the puzzles, get all the gems and crystals, and beat all the time trials. However, as the new release inadvertently acknowledges, the games that came out after the original Crash Team Racing weren't that great. Yes, I know there are defenders of Crash Bash, and that's fine, and there's plenty of people who have fond childhood memories playing the other sequels, but let's be honest, those games aren't the archetypal perfection of the original trilogy and CTR. With all of that considered, one could argue that we haven't had a truly great Crash game since the last century. A lot of longtime Crash fans, including myself, were hoping that Crash 4 would quench this long-term drought of quality. But does it? Let's find out. The majority of my review will center around Crash 4's gameplay, specifically the new mechanics, characters, and rewards. However, it wouldn't be a thorough review if I didn't address the graphics and the music, so we'll get that out of the way quickly and then get to all the juicy bits. First of all, if you have ever played a game from Toys for Bob, you'll know that graphical fidelity isn't their focus, let's say. What is their focus, though, is their art direction, which is consistently charming and colorful. There is always a sort of magical inventiveness to the worlds and characters they create. It's as if the developers over at Toys for Bob hooked up a computer to their inner child and let that child's imagination go mental. Obviously, the look of the game is supposed to appeal more to children, but I cannot help but feel enchanted by these new worlds that Toys for Bob created. They did a wonderful job preserving the soul of the original Crash Bandicoot worlds, but giving that soul a brand new coat of paint. Though I think I prefer the art direction and graphical fidelity of the Insane Trilogy, there's not such a drastic change in overall quality between that and Crash 4. Plus, it's not like we play Crash games for the graphics anyways, right? And a brief note on the music. Obviously, when we think of Crash Bandicoot's music, the first thing that comes to mind is that theme song captures all the fun and exhilaration of a Crash Bandicoot game perfectly. Not only that, but all the other songs from all the other games are so important in elevating the sense of adventure we had when jumping across a huge box-filled chasm or trying to perfect a speedrun. Toys for Bob had a real challenge ahead of them in terms of trying to replicate that sacred marriage between gameplay and music that the original trilogy had. Thankfully, everything gels together wonderfully. Not only are all the new songs bumping and fun, but the original theme is preserved. It's given a number of really cool reinterpretations, and those reinterpretations also seem to be based around the aesthetic of whichever level you are playing in. So for example, there is a world centered around a pirate theme. The first level you hop into in this world, you're met with this cool pirate-esque version of the original theme, and it's great. It's like I said with the graphics, it preserves the soul of the original Crash with a new coat of paint. Now to the gameplay. This is what we're all here to talk about, and there's a lot of stuff to cover. In Crash 4, the overall gameplay is expanded upon in two key ways. Firstly, it is done with new characters. As the promotional material has shown us, this isn't a spoiler, we now have the ability to play as Tawna, Dingo Dial, and Neo Cortex in several sections of the game. I was worried about this when I first heard about it. See, I was wondering whether these sections would feel like the Mary Jane sections from Spider-Man 2018, where you just want to get back to playing as Spider-Man every step of the way, or if it would be like Spyro 3, where the new playable characters add to the overall experience. Thankfully, it is the latter. Tana is now a Prince of Persia type badass hopping from wall to wall. Dingo Dial sucks up boxes in a very satisfying way. Sorry, I know that sounds wrong, but I couldn't think of a better way to put it. It's very satisfying gameplay. And Cortex's gunplay reminds me a lot of Agent 9's gameplay from the aforementioned Spyro 3. It's a welcome, entertaining break from the usual formula, but let's be honest, we play this game for Crash, right? Of course, Crash's gameplay is as addicting as ever. The familiar jumping and spinning dynamics are preserved. Personally, I would have been fine if I had gotten another game where it was just Crash breaking boxes and spinning enemies into the ninth ring of hell. However, Crash ends up doing so much more with the introduction of mask power-ups. I don't want to spoil what all of these masks do, because the first time you learn what a new mask does, everything becomes so much more exciting. However, I will use an example from the first two or three levels of the game. The mask known as Lanyululi can cause certain objects in the game world to phase in and out of existence. This adds another layer of intrigue to each level that utilizes this mask, forcing the gamer to use new dimensions of thought for each puzzle, literally and metaphorically. If the mask gameplay I'm showing you here intrigues you, then just know you haven't seen anything yet. Let's just say that if you enjoyed platformers like Braid or Limbo, then expect greatness as you get further into the game. Now, let's address the thing that is currently on the tip of everybody's tongue regarding this game, the difficulty. Before I go into detail, I want to be clear. I love this game's difficulty. I think it's a natural evolution of the difficulty we got from the original trilogy. If we were more of the same difficulty, I think Crash 4 would be a game that everybody perfected in 3 days and then never thought about again. The new layers of difficulty this game adds will preserve it in the collective conscious of gamers for years to come, alongside other difficult platformers like Super Meat Boy and Cuphead. Now I understand that there are probably some Soulsborne speedrunners who will watch this game and be like, Crash Bandicoot 4 isn't that hard, and that's great. However, you have to understand that badasses like you are in the minority, and this opinion of mine is backed up by Crash 4's new difficulty settings. When you start a new game, you are given the option between modern difficulty and retro difficulty. And below modern difficulty, you have the word recommended. Toys for Bob actively recommends against using the retro difficulty, at least for the first time. The reason why is because the retro life system, where you, of course, collect Wumpas and gain lives, fits the structure of the levels from the original games. In Crash 4, not only are there more levels than in any other Crash game, the levels are much longer, there are exponentially more boxes to find, and these factors together add up to infinitely more death. As a Crash Bandicoot veteran, I have to say that I am so glad I chose modern difficulty. There is no way I would have finished this game in time for a review if I chose retro. On the third last level of the game, I think I died upwards of 60 times, and on several of the other final levels, my death count went somewhere around 30 to 40 for each run through. It was brutal, but like I said, I love the difficulty. At no time does this game's difficulty ever seem unfair, and at all times I was sure of inevitable victory if I just pushed forward. One last word on the retro difficulty. I'm not saying you should avoid it. I think it would just be best to maybe save it for a second playthrough. The game is plenty difficult and challenging on modern difficulty, I promise. Now let's move on from that. There's now more reason to play through these games than just 100%ing everything and getting all the achievements and trophies. For each level, there is a skin you can unlock for your character. In order to unlock it, you have to find all the boxes, all the Wumpa fruit, a hidden gem, and to top it all off, refrain from dying more than 3 times. If you manage this for each level, you gain a new skin. Who would have thought, huh? You know, tying aesthetic rewards to competence rather than microtransactions? Anyways, the costumes are cool, and you can wear them as a badge of honor for yourself. However, I will use this particular thing to transition into the criticisms I have of the game, of which I only have a small amount. I think this game missed out on a huge opportunity by not having some version of online multiplayer. While it does have a couch co-op mode called Pass and Play, where you can test your ability to survive and gain points against a friend, you can only do this locally. I think this game's longevity could have been vastly prolonged if the Pass and Play multiplayer were taken online. You could show off how badass your platforming skills are depending on which skins you managed to get. You could get into real intense matches where you both tried to race to the end without dying. Then maybe the points you got from your victories could be spent on skins that you could get exclusively online. I would have gotten seriously addicted to something like that. Alas, we might have to wait until Crash 5 if there is a Crash 5 for something like that. Another minor thing that I didn't really like was the addition of the fireboxes. For the most part, these boxes that spew fire are mostly redundant. There's only a handful of times where the boxes actually add to the overall challenge of the game, in my opinion. Most of the time, I just stand next to the boxes waiting for them to cool down so I can break them. But like I said, just a minor thing, and you get over it very quickly. But there is one thing that I cannot get over, and it's a problem that carries over from the developer's past titles: load times. This is the only major problem I have with this game. I had the exact same problems with the Spyro remaster and the Insane trilogy, and somehow it's even worse here. And I've played all of these games on both the PS4 and PC. Let's say, for example, you make a mistake at the beginning of a level and you want to start over. On my end, I have to wait upwards of 40 seconds each time I want to do that. It's ridiculous. Why haven't they figured this out? Seriously, guys. As much as I look forward to your games, Toys for Bob, I start to simultaneously dread the load times with each new release. With all that said, however, those are really my only main criticisms. Crash Bandicoot 4 is the game I have dreamed of for the past 20 years. I love it. Not everybody will appreciate the difficulty of the game. I even question whether the game might be too hard for what is, I think, supposed to be a kid's game. But for me, it's perfection. I look forward to playing this game for years to come, trying to get all the gems, relics, and trophies. And I highly recommend it if you have fond memories of playing the OG Crash Bandicoot back in the day. My final score for this game is a solid 8.5 out of 10. I highly recommend that you go and buy it, because if you do, that will encourage Toys for Bob to do a Spyro 4, which I want more than anything in the world. Please, God. Anyways, thanks so much for watching, everybody. If you like this review, make sure to give it a like. That helps me out more than you know. Also, make sure to follow me on Twitch, Twitter, and join my Discord. All those links and more are in the description box below. Make sure to stay tuned for next week's video, where I do a deep dive into Bloodborne. Until then, just remember, as always, stay yellow.